Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? There is more in the solar system than just planets. In between Mars and Jupiter, there's an asteroid belt, and there are a number of objects within that asteroid belt that are visible to us, even with binoculars, and definitely with small telescopes. One of those that is very well seen right now is called Juno. It's called 3 Juno when you look it up as an asteroid, but it is actually only the 11th largest asteroid object. It happens to be pretty bright though. So because it's bright, it kind of sticks out. It has a very large eccentricity. So therefore it goes very far away, farther away than some asteroids and closer in than other ones. And as a result of that, it has very good years when it's ideally placed for us to see, and then others when it's much further away. So right now, this is actually one of the very best ones. It will reach opposition on November 17th. And this is also when it's closest to Earth, so it's actually very bright. When it's dim, it can be as low as magnitude 8.7, but right now it's at about magnitude 7.5. So I was able to see that in binoculars last night without any problem, and I'm going to show you where to find it. We look towards the southeast around 10 o'clock at night, and we can see Orion is over here in this direction, but we're going to look at the constellation just next to Orion. So we open up our sky and viewing options window. Click the labels and markers and slide that all the way over. And you can see there's 3 Juno as it pops up. If we look at our azimuth grid, we can see that it's nice and high up. We're well above 35 degrees, so not as much atmosphere to look through, which is a good thing. And if we bring up our constellation lines and labels, we can see that just next to Orion is this long, winding, and also dim constellation called Eridanus. And it actually extends from my location at 40 degrees north latitude, well below my horizon, and goes all the way down to a very bright star. So we're going to follow that river partway along its flow to help us find where Juno is at. So if we zoom in just a little bit, we can see, oh, Juno's not far off the river. Even if you look at, you can pull up the configuration window and look under extras and click on this show constellation boundaries button. This is actually a different way that Stellarium has changed this. So click on that and then you can close this, come down here, and then over here in your constellation labels and lines and things, click on this button for constellation boundaries, and you can see hopefully here on YouTube these red lines that show where Eridanus goes and where Orion is. So Juno is well within the constellation boundary lines of Eridanus. What we want to do, we don't need those up though necessarily, because we actually want to kind of look at the sky as we would see it and help us to guide our direction there. Now, a lot of these stars in Eridanus are faint. They're like fourth magnitude. However, there are a couple that can help us guide us on the way that are second and third magnitude. So right here, this star that looks like it's part of Orion actually isn't. This is Beta Eridani, and it is a 2.75 magnitude star. So if we look at that one, and then see this one right here in the middle of Orion, that's Alnilam. We're going to take our angle finder here, and we can see how that's just, 7 or 8 degrees away, so not too far away. We can follow that line all the way across to this star, which is actually, if you look from Cursa or Beta Eridani, it's about 20 degrees away. So 20 degrees is going to be a little bit further than holding your hand out at arm's length like this and putting your thumb and pinky all the way up. That's probably going to be about 22 degrees for most people. But that'll get you pretty close to being able to find where that star would be, because you're looking in what may be a fairly blank looking part of the sky. So look for those stars. And then look back and up just a little bit, because if we use binoculars, we would be able to come back over and say, okay, put that star, which actually, let me bring up the name of that one so you can see that. That's 34 Eridani. If we go back from 34, about a binocular field of view, so if you put it all the way to the right edge of your binocular field of view, and then go up, you would wind up catching these two stars just in the left side of your field of view. Those ones are the ones that we're looking for. But there's actually another way to do this too. We can follow the river itself. See how those lines go like that? Let's actually start at Cursa and we'll bring in our binoculars. We're going to go like this and these. And you can see how these stars are just bright enough that you're going to go, oh, I kind of know where I'm going here. This is pretty cool. These are bright enough stars. I can kind of hop my way over. And as you go over to, because you're going to move to the right, you'll see these stars. So that's Omicron 1, Eridani, and Omicron 2. Those are really helpful stars, and those are the two that I came back to from 34 Eridani. Once you find those stars, you're going to use them as your pointers. So you're going to follow those up, and actually, let's go over to 34 as well so you can see where that is relatively. See, there it is. Boom, 34. So if we go over and put that way over on the right-hand side of our field of view, and then up a little bit, there they are, just over on the left-hand side of our field. So we can find them fairly easy from a binocular or even a finder scope field of view. Now we're going to just go in that direction and keep going using them as pointers. But I'm going to leave them in at least Omicron 1 in the field of view because look, there's Juno. And it's right by this star, which is 32 Eridani. And 32 is going to be kind of the anchor star that you're going to want to use for about the next month or so to be able to find Juno. Because if we go forward in time, watch how Juno goes all the way through there. Look at that. That's going out at least 2 weeks. And there's not a lot of other stars that are as bright in that immediate neighborhood. There's just this one, which is 7.5. It's going to be exactly the same as Juno. See, Juno's 7.46. And then we've got this star, which is 7.7. But these, that's dimmer. That's an 8.5 magnitude star. This one is an 8.6 magnitude star. So we can follow Juno across away from 32 for a good long ways over the course of a number of nights until we get out to here, this star, 7.7 magnitude star. But everything else around there, pretty dim. So we can follow it as it goes for almost a month or so. And these stars that it starts to run into around the middle of December, these are faint. I mean, this is, 8.7. This is an 8.7 magnitude star. That is an 8.2 magnitude star. This is an 8.3 magnitude star. So Juno is still going to be a little brighter than those. You should be able to pick it out from there. It's not very big. It's so small, you won't see the size at all. However, you can watch it move because look how much it moves every single night. That's a lot of motion that it's going to have as it moves across the sky night by night by night by night night. So what you can do is look at it on multiple nights, which I would encourage you to do because you can watch this move from the stars. I think again, this is kind of your anchor star right here, 32, and just watch how it kind of speeds away from there over the next number of both days and weeks. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.